I'll start by acknowledging that I'm on Wajak Noongar land, and I just would like to put this slide up as a reminder of why we do what we do, and that is the impacts of foxes on biodiversity and the amazing heritage that we've inherited on this country and how we need to be protecting it. I'll talk briefly about a little bit of GPS tracking data and how I've interpreted this data. So this is a study that was carried out by Ed Swinhoe here in Perth, and he managed to trap and put trackers on 5 foxes. And these foxes were quite surprising. As Scott talked about, there's foxes that you kind of take for granted. They seem to be living in one discrete area, and they probably have quite a known home range, and they might be the ones which are easiest to trap. But on this slide, we also have the green dots all represent one fox that moved from around Lake Claremont, where Nick was talking about before, north. This is a distance of about 30 to 40 kilometres north. It moved up and down a coastal reserve where there are very few people, much as we've just heard presented on. They seem to really like that coastal area because the dunes are not always inhabited with people. And he ended up covering over 7,000 hectares compared with 300 hectares for 2 of our animals. The pink animal had moved a bit, as Scott was talking about, and the orange animal, that's a male, he was resident in that site. And then we had 2 other animals, 2 females, which had a much smaller home range, and they were pretty much confined to a park. Now, The interpretation from this is that foxes go a lot further than we might have thought before. A lot of the data which is published in the literature was based on VHF technology. And in VHF, you put a collar on a fox, and then you have to be able to get that animal back. You have to get close enough to be able to find it. And so when we've got data from home ranges before, they have lost a lot of the dogs, or sorry, a lot of the foxes that have gone beyond the range of where they were tracking, and those animals then didn't contribute to their estimates of home range. So this one fox that we tracked, he moved at least 11 kilometres a day, and that is using half-hourly fixes. So we know that that's the minimum distance he travelled, but it's quite likely that he spent a lot more time moving around between those 2 data points. When we look at the data for the speed at which they were moving, our foxes were doing quite different patterns of behaviour between day and night. In the daytime, that's the orange blocks on this graph at the top, they had much slower speeds, so they tended to be roosting up, sitting under a bush and not moving very far. By contrast, the black bars are the movements at night, and they had faster speeds closer to dawn. So they would move around slower at the beginning of the night, probably foraging early in the night, and then they would spend that time before dawn coming back to a safe spot to spend the rest of the day. We also found that they changed their movements when they were close to roads. So the daytime data, they don't really care. They're obviously not moving. They're sitting underneath the bush. They don't care how close to a road they are. But at night, the closer they are to the road, the faster they're moving. And the further away, the more likely they are to be foraging. So they commute. They move at speed along roads or close to roads. But then they tend to be going a lot slower and doing their foraging when they're away from roads. And they avoid roads, basically, and that's pretty sensible. They're dangerous places to be, and there's also probably not as many resources as there are in bushland. Now, these are the data for these 5 boxes. The 2 blue lines on each graph show you how much of each of the land uses were available to that fox. So I've put a 1 kilometre and a 3 kilometre buffer around the midpoint of where that fox was. And what's clear was that all of these foxes had a lot of residential areas available to them. So they had between 60 and 80% urban residential area. Now, we expected, based on the previous studies that have come out of the UK, for example, where they have foxes going through people's backyards, we'd expected that they would be using people's backyards. But what you'll see is the black bars. So if you take the guy on the top left-hand side, the black bar indicates what proportion of his data was actually found in a residential land use, and you'll see that it's absolutely tiny. Where you do see the big black bars is parkland, and all of these foxes showed preference for parkland. Up to 96% of all of the data points we got was around parkland. So this is one of those foxes. This is the animal from the top right-hand side of that map that we looked at originally. And you'll see, I've overlaid it with the aerial image. You'll see that this guy spent most of his time in an area that was parkland. He spends a little bit of time going north. He uses a road reserve to get up to a park. He doesn't spend a huge amount of time there. And he also spends a little bit of time tracking up and down the road east-west in this image. But most of his data points are confined by the limits of that road, that park. We found that they spent a lot of time on golf courses. As Scott presented, one of the animals that he had also spent a lot of time on golf courses. Not on the fairways, but they tend to be using the areas between the native vegetation that sits between the fairways. And with this supports data from other tracking studies, including in Edinburgh, where they had 75% of all the data points for one fox was using a golf course. And also in Canada, they found that they use golf courses similarly. Golf courses are great because there's very few people around in the middle of the day and there's few dogs. A study in Melbourne looking at where dens were found that two-thirds of those dens were found in areas where there was limited public access, and that is schools, cemeteries, industrial and commercial lands, and fenced parks, sporting clubs. And that's where these guys are hiding out, keeping away from people. So I've talked about a little bit about where they move, and that might help how we target where we can control them. But most people don't have access to lethal control or some of the tools that we've heard discussed. But if you do have foxes in your area, there are some really general things that you might be able to do. The first one is just stop feeding them. In Zurich in Switzerland, they found that half of all foxes had stomachs which are full of refuse. They loved fried chicken, for example. We had a study done just north of Perth where we found 97% of all the scats that we analysed had some anthropogenic food source, including mice. Mice are ubiquitous around our houses, and they are an important part of food for foxes. They also eat a lot of food. If you think about orchards and all the fruit fall on the ground, that just tends to sit and rot, and it gets picked up by foxes coming through. We have scats and stomachs that are full of mulberries and grapes and figs and blackberries. A lot of these are pest plants that grow up in riparian areas or in gardens that are left go. But they are really important food sources for these animals. The study in Zurich also showed that where a fox had a stomach full of dog food, it tended to have a full stomach. So a lot of people were putting food out for their pets outside. We put out bird food outside, and foxes will come along, and if they find a bowl full of food, they'll just gobble it all up. They'll come into chook pens and they'll eat not only the chickens, but they'll also take the food that you put out if they can access that. And they'll go through compost bins and rubbish. So we've also done a little bit of work on deterrence. The idea about deterrence is that they should be unpredictable and they should be reinforced. The one on the left-hand side is called a fox light, and this was developed by an Australian farmer who was going out with a head torch or a torch to go and check on lambs during lambing time. And he found that just having the torch out would keep the foxes away. And he's developed what is called a fox light. We've tested these, and the problem with the fox light is that they're constantly on, and foxes can really quickly habituate to them because they're always on. If you want to try a deterrent, try the one on the right. This is a really cheap alternative, and it's a sensor spotlight, and it will respond to the presence of the animal. So it's not on the whole time, and it will react to the animal's movement. And that's much more likely to trigger the fox to not become habituated. And we've done a study where we've looked at the sensor spotlights and combined them on a property that had chickens, free-range chickens, and they had Merrimah dogs. And the dogs would respond to the spotlight, and the two of them coupled together was the best deterrent for keeping foxes away from that property. So that's a consideration as well. The obvious one, if you want to keep your livestock safe, is fencing. But you've got to keep in mind that foxes dig. So the top right-hand side, this is a protection for turtles nesting, and to keep the foxes out, there's been a fence skirt dug into the ground. They also can climb really well, so you need to put a roof on your pen. And the one on the far left, this is a free-range chicken pen, and it's using an electric tape, which is poultry fencing. And it's not easy to climb up because it's elastic, but it's full of electric wires in that. And that's a really good way of keeping them out of chickens. And just thinking a little bit out of the box, we've done diet analyses where we've looked at what species of wildlife appear in fox diet as well as cat diet. And there's a way disproportionate number of species that live in open areas found in their diets. So quite simply, if a species lives in open areas, foxes and cats are much easier. They're much more efficient at hunting, and they find it much easier to get those prey, whereas animals in closed forests tend to appear less often in their diet. So thinking about how you might put dense plantings in areas where you wanted to protect your native species, not big enough that you can protect a whole fox then, but thinking about gardens, for example, people could do that, and they could actually show some initiative in putting in dense garden plantings, which would help protect the species that are in their gardens. And so that's just a summary of where I've got to. Just thinking about if you don't have access to lethal control, not reducing their numbers by not feeding them, and controlling their assets, our assets, by putting up fencing or using deterrents to keep them away. Thank you.